Christian Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Why God Makes Sense in a World That Doesn't, The Beauty of Christian Theism, by Gavin Ortlund, narrated by Al Kessel. The first thing that must strike a non-Christian about the Christian's faith is that it obviously presumes far too much. It is too good to be true. Hanser's von Balthasar. Preface. This book comes from my heart, more than anything else I have ever written. Don't get me wrong, it's an academic book. It seeks to be rigorous in argumentation and deep in the relevant secondary literature. Some passages get technical. At the same time, as it is overflowed from personal excitement, this book has also taken on a tone and quality that I hope will have a broader and more personal reach. I have labored to make it an accessible and enjoyable read for any thoughtful and sincere reader as much as possible. Down with boring books! Down with obligatory reading! The subject matter at hand is too enthralling. If we are not captivated and delighted along the way, something is amiss. I tell you that I've given you my best effort as a writer so that I may invite you to give the book your best effort as a reader. We live in an age of distraction and sound bites. The careful reading of books is not our defining strength. But if you will give me your attention, I will do everything I can to make it worth your effort. My passion for this book derives from my own experience. Over the last several years, I have become utterly absorbed in philosophical literature pertaining to the question of God. I remember the day in December 2018, browsing around at Bart's Books, a famous bookstore where I live in Ojai, California, when I first self-consciously resolved to give myself to this task as my next great intellectual effort. I'd been a bit depressed, having just completed several other book projects in historical theology, my area of formal training, and wondering where to turn my energies next. Philosophy had been my first intellectual love. It was in college, reading Kierkegaard and Wittgenstein and Camus, that I first understood how fun it could be to think. And for several years, my interest in apologetics had been steadily brewing, though fueled more by YouTube debates than academic reading. That day, I came across several of the so-called New Atheist books: Richard Dawkins' The God Delusion, Christopher Hitchens' God Is Not Great, and Sam Harris's The End of Faith. I vividly remember the longing that came over me as I leafed through them. It felt like my feet finding the path again. I knew what my next adventure would be. I bought all three books and headed to the park. Since that day, philosophical questions of a religious nature have become a central absorbing passion in my life, occupying my mind on bike rides, during swims and hikes, while playing soccer with the kids in the backyard, and at various sleepless hours of the night. More than once since then, I have prayed, "Lord, if you give me anything else to accomplish in my life, please let me write this book." In the process, I have come to feel that the needs of the times call for a slightly different approach to apologetics, which I explain in the introduction. A couple of brief explanatory matters are in order, in the hope of avoiding misplaced expectations for your sake, and one-star Amazon reviews from mine. First, as I explain in the introduction, this book is not a comprehensive treatment of all worldviews, but especially focuses on two options: Christianity and naturalism. My reason for restricting my focus to Christianity and naturalism is twofold. One, those are the options most people I know are considering, and two, those are the options I am best equipped to write about. So if you're trying to decide between, say, theism and pantheism, this book will not likely help you much. Furthermore, I don't address every difference between naturalism and Christianity. There are other books that give more of a survey approach to top objections or top issues. Rather, I'm trying to get at the big picture of how each worldview functions. I'm interested in the questions, what kind of story does each tell about our world? And which story is more satisfying to both mind and heart? By naturalism, I mean the philosophy that only physical laws and forces exist, such that there is nothing beyond the realm of nature. As I note in the introduction, some of my arguments are merely against naturalism. Others are for theism generally, and others are for Christian theism specifically, which is what the arguments cumulatively entail. Thus, the word supernaturalism comes up now and again for convenience. By it, I simply mean any worldview that posits some entity, whether personal or impersonal, beyond the natural order. For my purposes here, I classify the multiverse hypothesis as within the bounds of naturalism if all the other universes in the multiverse are understood to be reductively physicalist and bound by the same natural laws as our observable universe. I wish to give sincere thanks to Andrew Wolgamuth, my literary agent, for his wonderful encouragement, friendship, and hard work. To all of the team at Baker Academic, who were a delight to work with and contributed to this project in numerous ways, especially Dave Nelson for overseeing the project, and James Corsmo for his careful editorial work. To Tim Keller, whose approach to the topics addressed in this book I relate to so sincerely and intuitively, and whose various sermons and books I have absorbed so appreciatively that I almost regard him as an old friend, even though we have actually met on only one occasion, and I have no reason to expect him to reciprocate such interest. To those who read portions of the manuscript and gave feedback, especially Jeff Swerink, Joel Chopp, and Eric Ortlund. To my wife Esther for her tireless support, love, and encouragement in my writing and everything else. And to my children, Isaiah, Naomi, Elijah, and Miriam, who fill my daily life with laughter and delight, and to whom I dedicate this book. Introduction. Beauty, Story, and Probability in the Question of God. Suppose Hamlet is searching for Shakespeare. He cannot find him in the way he might find other characters in the play, like Ophelia or Claudius. So, where should he look? Hamlet's knowledge of Shakespeare will be different than anything else in his life. On the one hand, finding Shakespeare will be very difficult. Shakespeare is very far removed. Hamlet has never encountered him. On the other hand, the knowledge of Shakespeare might also prove unavoidable. For, in a deeper sense, Shakespeare is very close. Hamlet has never done anything but encounter him. As Hamlet's creator, Shakespeare is at once beyond his every device and inside his every thought. This book is about the knowledge of God, who, if he exists, is to us something like what Shakespeare is to Hamlet. For instance, if God is real, he will be both infinitely close and infinitely far. He is infinitely close because reality itself abides within him. Each breath we breathe is a gift from him. As Augustine put it, God is closer to us than we are to ourselves. He is infinitely far because he is qualitatively different than anything we have ever known. He surpasses us constantly at every level. For all eternity, we could search him out and still always have infinitely more to discover. As Job observed, how faint the whisper we hear of him. Job chapter 26, verse 14, New International Version. The question of God is thus unparalleled in all of life in several ways. It is, first, the most important and thrilling adventure of our lives. Nothing could be more urgent than whether He exists, and if so, what to do about it. For God is held to be the supreme good, who alone can fulfill the longings of the human soul. Therefore, the stakes of finding Him are literally infinite. Sex, achievement, food and drink, relationship, these are mere trifles to the human heart in comparison with God, the source of all things, the goal of all things, the ever-flowing fountain of all beauty and glory. The question of God is, secondly, the most fascinating puzzle you will ever think about, whether or not He is real. Certainly a more interesting idea has never been conceived. The concept, God, the infinite person, the ground of being, the precondition of reality, is the most staggering, enthralling idea ever to confront the human mind. The mere idea of God outweighs the physical universe in grandeur and importance. Finally, the question of God is the most difficult and humbling question we will face. Take the feeling of smallness you have when standing before the Grand Canyon or approaching a king, then multiply that feeling many times over, and you get the idea. That is what we are up against. It will take all our courage, all our hope, all our yearning. This book is a journey into the question of God. It explores four classic arguments for the existence of God. We will approach these arguments, however, in three distinctive ways, and I want to explain these distinctives in advance. Appealing to beauty. In his famous Pensée, Blaise Pascal proposed a threefold strategy for commending God, particularly the Christian God, to those who don't believe. Men despise religion. They hate it and are afraid it might be true. The cure for this is first, 1, to show that religion is not contrary to reason, but worthy of reverence and respect. Next, 2, make it attractive. Make good men wish it were true, and then, 3, how that it is. This is an intriguing strategy. To summarize, Pascal proposes a threefold order of apologetics. 1. Show religion to be respectable. 2. Show religion to be desirable. 3. Show religion to be true. Many efforts at Christian apologetics start with Pascal's third step, as though having powerful arguments were the main task at hand. Pascal's approach reflects a kind of practical wisdom in starting further back, at the psychological level. After all, few decisions are the result of strictly rational factors. We are not robots. This is especially the case with the question of God, the most inward and poignant question of all. For this reason, Pascal also taught that the truth of God is such that it will never be recognized apart from love, inwardness, and longing. My approach in this book is especially alert to the second stage of Pascal's apologetic strategy. I'm interested in the effective dimension of these classical arguments and their appeal to the whole person and in what they reveal about the beauty of Christianity. Whatever else you conclude about the Christian story, my goal is that you will at least feel something of its wonder and enchantment. Even where you may remain unpersuaded, I hope you might, in some way or another, wish it were true. My own experience is that when the gospel is truly understood and embraced, particularly in contrast to naturalistic worldviews, it feels like stepping through the wardrobe into Narnia. The empty tomb means supreme happiness, like the feeling of waking up as a little child on Christmas morning, or of learning that your true love actually loves you back. You know you have gotten a whiff of it when this thought arrives. Can it really be that good? This book tries to help us feel that, as well as, in the other direction, feel something of the confinement and barrenness of naturalism. Well, of course, beauty in itself is not a sufficient criterion for adjudicating truth. The fact that we desire something to be true does not make it true. At the same time, desire is not irrelevant to truth either. Desire is itself a piece of data that must be taken into account and interpreted alongside other data. For example, hunger might not prove you have food, but it might suggest to you that there is such a thing as food out there, somewhere. Similarly, if we notice within our hearts deep-seated longings for things like meaning, love, and lasting hope, longings so powerful that life seems unendurable without them, this very fact may prove relevant, alongside other considerations, to our overall assessment of the world that produces creatures with such longings. This interest in the interplay between beauty and truth is an ancient instinct. The Greek philosopher spoke of the three transcendentals: the good, the true, and the beautiful. Christians have historically put a great deal of reflection into how the gospel relates to each one of these three, and why it is important to commend the gospel not only as true, but as good and as beautiful. Hans Urs von Balthasar, who has perhaps more than anyone else developed a theology of aesthetics, argued that in the modern world, truth without beauty is powerless and ineffectual. In a world that no longer has enough confidence in itself to affirm the beautiful, the proofs of the truth have lost their cogency. In other words, syllogisms may still dutifully clatter away like rotary presses or computers, which infallibly spew out an exact number of answers by the minute. But the logic of these answers is itself a mechanism which no longer captivates anyone. Similarly, von Balthasar claimed that goodness apart from beauty becomes unstable and arbitrary. David Bentley Hart has likewise urged that the Christian gospel addresses the world not primarily as a series of arguments, but as a story involving a unique interrelation of truth and beauty, making its appeal first to the eye and heart as the only way it may command assent. The church cannot separate truth from rhetoric or from beauty. This vision of the unity of the transcendentals is an ancient one, but it has fresh relevance in our current cultural moment for at least three reasons. First, we live in a time of disillusionment and disenchantment, and stemming from this, a time of apathy about truth. Accordingly, the greatest impediment to the hearing of the gospel is usually not opposition, but indifference. Soren Kierkegaard famously used aesthetic writing to engage those not already interested in religious questions. When people are under the illusion that they have no dire spiritual need, Kierkegaard considered it necessary to communicate indirectly, because direct communication presupposes that the receiver's ability to receive is undisturbed. Though Kierkegaard's context, Christendom, differs from our own, the genius of his general strategy of communication is ever relevant. Beauty is a powerful tool for cutting through disenchantment and apathy because it has a kind of persuasive power that reaches down to the heart. As Sarah Zylstra put it, even as our neighbors lose belief in the truth of the gospel, they're still, on a gut level, looking for its goodness and beauty. Beauty speaks at this gut level. It travels at a wavelength that even the disenchanted can hear. I have known many people, for example, who have come to Christ through reading The Lord of the Rings or C.S. Lewis's fiction. I suspect that part of the reason is that there is a beauty in these stories that simply cannot be accounted for within the limits of a nihilistic worldview. Second, we live in an age of distraction and diversion. Pascal famously wrote, "The sole cause of man's unhappiness is that he does not know how to stay quietly in his room." I used to think this was an interesting sentiment, but something of an overstatement for effect. It was only recently, when I gave the pensée a thorough read in preparation for this book, that the genius and relevance of Pascal's comment fully dawned on me. In context, he is arguing that our inability to consider the one central, certain fact of life, death and what lies beyond it, represents a kind of supernatural spell or torpor. All I know is that I must soon die, but what I know least about is this very death which I cannot evade. The way we avoid facing the ultimate questions, meaning and death, is by filling our lives with distractions. However sad a man may be, if you can persuade him to take up some diversion, he will be happy while it lasts. This is Pascal's point. If we could stay quietly in our room, we'd be forced to slow down enough to attend to our true condition. Beauty can help the distracted just as it can help the disenchanted. Beauty conveys a sense that there is something richer beneath the surface of our hurried lives and that it is worth slowing down to consider it. Peter Kraft calls beauty goodness's prophet. Beauty has its own kind of testimonial power, helping us feel the stakes of religious questions, compelling us to stop and listen. Third, we live in a time of outrage and polarization. Intriguingly, as our culture has grown more morally pluralistic, it has also grown more morally incensed. There is also a great deal of pessimism about the future and a deep longing for transcendent experience. Beauty is one way to engage people more effectively because it enables us to appeal more comprehensively to the various questions and anxieties that people have. It might allow us to strike a more winsome, invitational tone than is usually present amid the entrenchment and rancor that often characterize public dialogue. An appeal to beauty can better speak to the moral concerns of our polarized culture as well. A Christian apologist once remarked to me that on university campuses 30 years ago, he was asked more questions about Christianity's truth. Does God exist? Did Jesus rise from the dead, etc.? Today, he is asked more questions about Christianity's goodness. Is the church intolerant? Are Christians homophobic, etc.? I think this is broadly representative of our whole culture. Thus, if we commend only the truth of Christianity and neglect the appeal to beauty and goodness, we are actually not hitting the central, animating concerns of our culture. That is why, in the chapters that follow, we explore not only the strength of the arguments in view, but also their beauty and relevance to human desire. Seeking a better story. A second characteristic of this book is that I approach arguments in a narrative frame. That is, I treat them not as standalone proofs, but rather as entry points into a larger, more cohesive question. What is the overall shape of reality? What kind of story best explains our world? This simultaneously entails more of a cumulative approach. Alistair McGrath defines narrative apologetics as an approach to affirming, defending, and explaining the Christian faith by telling stories. This is part of what I'm pursuing here, but I'm also after something more. I'm interested not only in how stories show truth, but also in how truth presents itself to us as, ultimately, a story. Hence the Shakespeare/Hamlet metaphor at the start of this book, to which we will return. I believe narrative has a unique power to convince in our current context for a variety of reasons. 1. It appeals more naturally to the heart, will, and imagination. 2. It can be less confrontational and more inviting. 3. It is better able to furnish meaning and convey beauty. 4. It conveys truth more concretely. 5. It has greater ability to break through cynicism and apathy. 6. It has greater explanatory reach. 7. It is better positioned to address the problem of evil. Why are stories so powerful? Storytelling is one of the most fundamental human activities. Stories are part of how all cultures, ancient and modern, seek to make sense of the world. Movies are probably our culture's dominant method of storytelling. As Ursula Le Guin puts it, there have been great societies that did not use the wheel, but there have been no societies that did not tell stories. In other words, human beings have always made sense of the world through stories. For good or ill, this is how we tend to navigate ultimate questions. Christians, in particular, have often interpreted our humanity in terms of our tendency to tell stories. Dorothy Sayers, for example, argued that storytelling is at the heart of what it means to be made in the image of God. For J.R.R. Tolkien as well, storytelling is a function of being created in God's image. We make in our measure and in our derivative mode, because we are made, and not only made, but made in the image of a maker. Tolkien developed the notion of subcreation to describe this reality, suggesting that the human tendency is to tell stories that are unconsciously patterned after the great story, the true story, the story of Christ. This point was significant in the famous conversation that he and Hugo Dyson had with C.S. Lewis in September 1931 that was instrumental in Lewis's conversion. We will return to Tolkien's idea of subcreation later. In line with this interest in story, the four arguments of this book are situated in a narrative form, as four of the essential aspects of any good story. Chapter 1 explores the possibility that our world has a beginning. Chapter 2 explores the possibility that our world has a meaning. Chapter 3 explores the possibility that our world has a conflict or drama. Chapter 4 explores the possibility that our world has an ultimate hope or denouement. Each chapter thus gets progressively more ambitious. Chapter 1 proposes supernaturalism of some kind, favoring theism or possibly deism. Chapter 2 furthers the appeal for supernaturalism, this time more concretely a personal supernatural reality, again with theism as the lead candidate. Chapter 3 argues more definitively for theism, emphasizing that supernatural reality appears not only to be a personal entity, but also a righteous, moral one. Chapter 4 hones in on the Christian deity specifically. Thus, this book considers Christianity versus naturalism in relation to the basic elements that all stories have: origins, meaning, conflict, and hope. The constant question will be, which is telling us a better story? A story that better accounts for the strangeness, the incompleteness, the brokenness, and the beauty of our world? Using abductive arguments. A final characteristic of my approach to apologetics in this book is that I tend to use abductive arguments more than deductive and inductive arguments. In formal logic, abduction is a distinct form of inference from deduction and induction. Deductive arguments start with premises and then reason toward a conclusion that is logically necessary, inductive arguments work similarly, but yield only a probable conclusion. Abductive reasoning, however, works backward from a present set of conditions to the most likely explanation. Sometimes it is called inference to the best explanation. So, for example, suppose you have a roommate who loves eating Wendy's, and on one morning you wake up and you see a half-eaten Baconator on the counter. No one else lives with you, and you are not aware of visitors. It is reasonable to adduce, "It's probably from my roommate," but it's not logically guaranteed that that is the case. There could have been an unknown visitor, or even a burglar. While abductive reasoning yields a less certain conclusion, it can still be persuasive, especially in the context of a cumulative case. Abduction should not be thought of as an untrustworthy method of inference. It plays a significant role in everyday life. For instance, trusting the speech of others, and it is regularly used by diagnosticians, juries, mechanics, detectives, and by those in many other professions. In some ways, abductive reasoning even has some advantages. For example, here it will help us not get bogged down chasing specialized knowledge that lies beyond the typical reader. So when I'm talking about the origins of the universe or the fine-tuning argument, an abductive approach allows us to ask, what is the best explanation? What is most likely? I think such arguments have plausibility value for most readers, even if they fall short of pressing the issue as far as a more technical presentation could. In fact, I find that many people, especially younger people, find the modesty involved in abductive approaches actually more compelling. Another benefit of abductive arguments is that they allow us to consider a greater variety of data, including data from the realm of human experience. It is possible to suggest God not as the conclusion of a thread of reasoning, but as the premise of human experience. This approach says, in effect, if God doesn't exist, so much of life, so much of what we already assume in the way we function, becomes more mysterious and inexplicable. This kind of appeal does not necessarily prove God, but it can draw attention to what a powerful explanatory framework belief in God provides for understanding things like love, meaning, beauty, and so forth. So you might think of the four chapters of this book each as a sort of Pascalian wager. Pascal famously emphasized the unavoidability of the question of God. Short of intellectual certitude, we must still live on the basis of some kind of decision, even if that decision is simply to not think about the question. In this book, we are pursuing this kind of realistic approach to the deepest question we all face. What is, all things considered, the best choice regarding the God question? Help from Puddleglum. Let me conclude this introduction on a personal note. The kind of apologetics I am proposing here is not a theoretical exercise. It has been to me like a life raft in stormy seas. I am a Christian, and I have never rejected faith. But during certain seasons of my life, I have agonized my way through various doubts and intrusive thoughts. I've had a number of friends who have been through similar seasons of doubt and deconstruction. If you've been there or are there, you know how confusing and painful that experience can be. I think we can expect that, in our cultural context, such experiences will not be going away anytime soon. The modern West is marked by a deep sense of the loss of transcendence and certainty, a feeling of disenchantment, as though life has been drained of its former glory and meaning. The general drift is away from stability and toward despair. I worry that many within the church, especially in younger generations, are ill-equipped to navigate these times. Frankly, It seems to me that Christians often fail to take the challenges seriously enough. Sometimes in dark moments, I have been gripped by the dreadfulness of the naturalistic view that tugs at us from all around. In those moments, I have found enormous relief and comfort in the kind of beauty-oriented, narrative-abductive approach I'm taking here. As a summative expression of this approach, consider this passage from the character Puddleglum in C.S. Lewis's Narnia stories. Puddleglum is a rather gloomy character based on Lewis's pessimistic gardener. In the book, The Silver Chair, Puddleglum and his friends are held underground and tempted by an evil sorceress to doubt all that they believe is good about the world, the sun, the stars, and Aslan himself, the Christ figure. Puddleglum's reply sums up several of the intuitions involved in the approach in this book, especially my interest in the emotional factor of belief. "One word, ma'am. One word. All you've been saying is quite right. I shouldn't wonder. I'm a chap who always liked to know the worst and then put the best face I can on it. So I won't deny any of what you said. But there's one thing more to be said even so. Suppose we have only dreamed or made up all those things, trees and grass and sun and moon and stars and Aslan himself. Suppose we have. Then all I can say is that, in that case, the made-up things seem a good deal more important than the real ones. Suppose this black pit of a kingdom of yours is the only world. Well, it strikes me as a pretty poor one, and that's a funny thing when you come to think of it. We're just babies making up a game, if you're right. But four babies playing a game can make a play world which licks your real world hollow. That's why I'm going to stand by the play world. I'm on Aslan's side, even if there isn't any Aslan to lead it. I'm going to live as like a Narnian as I can, even if there isn't any Narnia. So, thanking you kindly for our supper, if these two gentlemen and the young lady are ready, we're leaving your court at once and setting out in the dark to spend our lives looking for overland. Not that our lives will be very long, I should think. But that's small loss if the world's as dull a place as you say." I have always found this passage to be a forceful statement against nihilistic worldviews. Some will dismiss its relevance, of course, since it comes in a children's book. But Lewis was a master of stating profound ideas in simple, clear language. Here, Lewis is utilizing a particularly powerful and profound idea. The ontological argument, my favorite idea of all time, and applying it to modern despair. Puddleglum is not advocating for a mere wishful thinking here. He is not saying, it doesn't matter what is true, it only matters what is beautiful. Rather, Puddleglum is bringing considerations of beauty to bear on the question of truth. He is adopting the sorcerer's outlook as a hypothetical. Note the repeated word, suppose, and noting its utter desolation even on its own terms. Taken in the best way, Puddleglum's appeal does not amount to, your world is true, but I reject it anyway, but rather to, supposing your world were true, I would reject it anyway. And that may well suggest it might not be true. Puddleglum's sentiments point to the sheer oddity of a nihilistic world. If all the really stable, happy doctrines of Christianity, say, God or heaven, or the triumph of good over evil, are false, and in reality our lives are a meaningless blip in a vast and indifferent cosmos, then the ideas in our brain are in a very real sense more weighty than the reality that brought our brains into existence. That is not very easy to swallow, and it is even more difficult to live off of. Puddle Glum is also saying, and my eyes well up with tears as I write this, at the deepest existential level, a true faith perseveres in hope, even when it does so blindly and forlornly, setting out in the dark, as Puddle Glum puts it. The mere possibility of God drives it on in the blackest moments. It fights with all the strength it can muster. For all of us, the question of God is likely to take on this poignant feel at some time or another. Honest believers will likely have foreboding moments of disquiet. What if it's all a sham? Honest skeptics will likely have panicky moments of hesitation. What if it's true after all? Whether we are in one of these camps or somewhere in the confusing middle, we must admit that we care deeply about the truth of the matter at hand. It's personal. There is no good in pretending that we are completely objective and rational about it. The thing to do is, with all the courage we can muster, acknowledge our biases, face our fears, and unendingly seek truth. Whatever your personal angle of approach, my hope is that this book will help you feel, in perhaps some new way, the beauty of the gospel, that feeling of hope and goodness like when, at long last, the night is over and the sun starts to rise. This way, even if you are not yet convinced of its truth, you may at the very least be better positioned to feel the immensity of what is at stake in the question. For it is the question of all questions, the question that concerns the deepest places in our hearts, the question that will determine the fate of literally everything. 1. The cause of the world. Why something is more plausible and much more interesting than nothing. The idea that things don't come into being without a reason is pretty intuitive. That the entire universe didn't come into existence without a reason, even more so. One might suppose that the rejection of such a possibility, a universe that began but lacks a cause for its beginning, is among those constraints with which rational reflection generally begins. Arguments for God as the first cause, or cosmological arguments, draw upon this intuition that if the universe began, it must have had a cause. Such arguments can feel very powerful. Often when I reconsider them, I feel their forcefulness all over again, as if it were hitting me for the first time. But did the universe come into being from nothing? It turns out that this is no easy question. Today, there is a complicated body of views on the origins of the universe, many of which affirm some kind of cyclical or self-caused start to the universe. And engaging this discussion pulls you into some pretty technical areas within cosmology, the branch of astronomy concerned with the origin and evolution of the universe. You start off wanting to say, innocently enough, that the universe didn't go poof from nothing. But to defend the point, you find yourself talking about oscillating universes, quantum mechanics, eternal inflation theories, various definitions of the word nothing, no boundary conceptions of time, and so forth. More on all this later. To complicate matters further, many forms of the cosmological argument don't involve the claim that the universe began to exist. In fact, putting all the focus on the universe's origins can actually obscure the deeper metaphysical point that has animated cosmological arguments throughout the classical theistic tradition. Namely, how do we account for existence as such? Why is there anything at all? A beginningless universe doesn't actually take this question off the table. So in this chapter, we attempt an abductive approach that will allow us to traverse more lightly through the technical issues involved, while also keeping an eye on the larger metaphysical and worldview implications throughout. We first consider what the best explanation for the origins of our universe is. Short of getting a PhD in theoretical physics, what is the most responsible and reasonable hypothesis with regard to whether the universe began? Following this, we turn to the larger philosophical question, whether our universe or the multiverse it inhabits had a beginning or not. Does it make more sense to understand it as deriving its being from something else, or as a kind of self-existent brute fact? In response, I suggest two modest conclusions. First, some kind of transcendent cause to the universe / multiverse is more plausible than not. Second, it is more interesting and evocative. So think of this chapter as simply putting a foot in the door against naturalism. More work will need to be done. Here, at the outset, we're simply trying to crack open the metaphysical possibilities and suggest some initial, provisional impressions. What made the Big Bang go bang? The term Big Bang was first coined by the English astronomer Fred Hoyle during a radio address in March 1949. Hoyle was advocating for a steady-state model of the universe, in which new matter is continually created as galaxies move away from each other. He set this theory in contrast to the major rival theory at the time, which he described as the view that all the matter in the universe was created in one Big Bang at a particular time in the remote past. For Hoyle, the idea of a beginning to the universe was pseudoscientific and irrational, too closely resembling creationism. Hoyle was trying to account for one of the great surprises of the 20th century, the discovery that our universe is expanding. This had been recognized since the 1920s in the wake of Einstein's general theory of relativity. In 1922, the Russian physicist Alexander Friedman first theorized the expansion of the universe and offered a set of equations to describe it. In 1927, the Belgian Catholic priest and astronomer, Georges Lemaître, proposed a model for the expansion of the universe that was subsequently confirmed by a variety of observational science, such as Edwin Hubble's explanation of the redshift of galaxies in 1929, which established that they are moving away from the Earth at velocities proportional to their distance. For several decades during the mid-20th century, the Big Bang theory and the steady-state theory competed as rival explanations for the expansion of our universe. But eventually, despite Hoyle's continued protests, even late into his life, the Big Bang model won out, supported by a wide variety of data. This led to theories about an initial singularity, which represents the boundary or edge of space-time itself. In 1970, Stephen Hawking and Roger Penrose proposed that, given the validity of general relativity and a few other conditions, such as that energy is always positive, going back in time leads to an initial state at which the density of time, space, matter, and energy is infinite and the laws of physics break down. This is the standard hot model of the Big Bang, based on the Hawking-Penrose singularity theorems and building on the earlier work of Friedman and Lemaître. There are all kinds of continuing disputes about how we should understand Big Bang cosmology, some of which we will engage in a moment. But the core claim that our universe traces back to an absolute beginning and is therefore finite in history has been the standard cosmological view since the 1960s. It is hard to convey just how explosive, forgive the pun, this discovery has been in the history of science. Science is stereotypically seen as an objective and dispassionate pursuit of evidence, but the notion of an absolute beginning has created surprisingly emotional reactions. The distinguished physicist and astronomer, Robert Jastrow, observed that many scientists have found the idea downright disturbing. Why is this? Jastrow suggests that it is because it violates scientists' faith in the sufficiency of natural causes. Scientists seek to explain the world in terms of natural laws, but natural laws are formulated in relation to space and time, and thus cannot apply to the singularity at which space and time break down. The Big Bang opens the door to the possibility of reality outside the purview of what can be accounted for by science. It leads us to the very boundary of the physical, and thus gestures toward the metaphysical. Jastrow argues that if any scientist really examined the implications, he would be traumatized. Having opened his book stating he is an agnostic, he closes the book gesturing toward the theological implications. For the scientist who has lived by his faith and the power of reason, the story ends.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.